Okay. Show me.
Hi there, guys. Welcome back to the Dutch Sushi Channel. Thank you very much for tuning in. And I've got a box from HGLRC. And I must admit, I'm not completely sure if you can actually read HGLRC. It's a silvery logo on a white box. Trust me, this box is in fact from HGLRC. Now, this is actually exciting to me. And if you follow my channel, you know that I haven't had an HGLRC product for quite a while. In fact, the last time I did an HGLRC video, it was for a giveaway of the famous XJB145. One of the most popular 3-inch quadcopters ever, I think. Yeah, so today I've got me a new HGLRC and I'm anxious to try this one out. This one definitely caught my attention, so that's why I have it here. This box contains the Sector 132, which is a videography quadcopter, a cinematic quadcopter, but it's basically two quadcopters in one. You'll see that in a minute. It's you can configure it in two ways and you'll definitely have two different kinds of quadcopters with that. Let's get into it. There you go. And the first thing you see is the actual quadcopter. Now, this quadcopter is actually available in three versions, with a FlySky receiver, with an FRSky receiver, which is what I have here, or without a receiver, so you can add your own. Also, I think it's available in two colors. I have the one with the black propeller guards, and there's also a version with blue ones. Yeah, so the first thing I noticed when I took a peek in the box is that it actually even comes with the antenna tubes installed. It's almost ready to go. So there's more in the box, of course. Let me take everything out of the box and show you what we've got. My lord, you get a lot of stuff with this HGLRC Sector 132. Okay, here you see the quadcopter and it's a 2.5 and a 3-inch quadcopter all in one. Yeah, and it's got a 4K recorder. In this case, it's got the Cadex Target 4K. And okay, more on the quadcopter in a second, because we've got quite a few accessories to cover, which is a good thing, of course. It's nice to get a lot of stuff with your quadcopter. So the first thing is this FPV antenna. The antenna actually doesn't say if it's right or left hand circular polarized. I am going out on a limb and guess that it's right hand circular polarized. And if it's not, I'll put that on screen for you right now. So if there's no text on screen, this antenna is right-hand circular polarized. And actually, this is a little outside of the norm. It's RP-SMA, which means that the antenna doesn't have a pin. The quadcopter itself has a pin over here. Keep that in mind. If you are shopping for maybe a replacement antenna for this quadcopter, you need an RP-SMA antenna. Also, if you are relatively new to quadcopters, the first thing you definitely want to do is screw on that antenna so that you can't forget to see if you power up your quadcopter without that antenna on, you will very much likely be burning up your VTX, your video transmitter. So put that on right away. Then we've got a lot of propellers. A lot of propellers, more than you'd probably expect. Again, this quadcopter is two quadcopters in one, so you get two kinds of propellers. And let me see, you get one complete set of 2.5-inch propellers and two spares of those, right? And you get one set of 3-inch propellers and one set of spares, two spares of those as well. So I'll get to that in a second, but basically, again, this is a 2-in-1 quadcopter with the propeller guards on. It's a 2.5-inch quadcopter for the smaller propellers. Without the prop guards in place, you can use the 3-inch propellers. So again, a lot of propellers with this quadcopter. Very, very nice. Then we get two battery strips, or one battery strip and one for an action camera, if you'd so want to. And these are anti-slip. They are stitched and they have a metal buckle. They are pretty long as well, by the way. So yeah, good straps, very, very nice. You get a set of screws, a lot of screws, and I'm assuming that most of these screws will be to mount your propellers on the motors, but there's definitely also some spare screws for probably the frame, which is nice to see. You also get the documentation, not a manual, but the documentation for the receiver. In my case, it's the XM Plus from FR Sky. And again, there's also a Fly Sky version available of this quadcopter. You'll get some decals, HGLSC decals. I love getting decals, very nice. And there's more documentation on the quadcopter itself. This is on the 401 ESC flight controller and the VTX. Very nice. Okay, one sheet. And that should be more than enough. I'm assuming that this quadcopter is 99% ready to go. In my case, the receiver is already in place, so I need to bind that up. Otherwise, yeah, set up a model in the radio. But that should basically be everything I need to do to get this one flying. And the last two things in the box were these two TPU mounts. Now this Sector 132 is actually available as a DJI digital quadcopter. And I have obviously an analog version. However, they do provide the mounting TPU bracket for the DJI air unit, which is nice. Maybe you want to convert your quadcopter afterwards. You do have that bracket. Very nice. And this, you get a camera mount. Yeah, this is for an action camera. Again, the quadcopter comes with a 4K recorder already, but maybe you want to add a better camera, say a GoPro session. With this mount, you can simply screw that on to the front of the quadcopter and you have yourself an action camera mount. All right, guys, the Sector 132 from HDLRC, a 2.5-inch and a 3-inch cinematic quadcopter. Yeah, and that's one of the main selling points, I think. It's two quadcopters in one. Maybe you are a beginner and you want to progress into this hobby. You can start out with a slightly less powerful quadcopter, 2.5-inch propellers and propeller guards. So if you run into someone or something, you're less likely to damage that person or that object and the quadcopter itself. And after a while, maybe your flying skills have improved. You get rid of the propeller guards, slot on the 3-inch propellers, and you have a more powerful, faster quadcopter. All for one. Very, very nice. Also, however, these propeller guards will also help you out in forests, for instance. If you fly through forests and you miss the tiny branches, these propeller guards will help you fly through them. Not the really big branches, of course, but the phantom branches that are hard to see, you will just be pushing those out of the way with these propeller guards. This is not the first quadcopter I have with propeller guards like these. These are very resilient and again they will push the little branches out of the way. Very, very nice. So I will probably be flying the quadcopter without the propeller guards mostly myself. But it's definitely a very nice option. If you want to remove these propeller guards, you will have to disassemble the quadcopter slightly. You'll have to remove all four motors. The four motors are held down with four screws, as you can hopefully see. And yeah, then you can remove the propeller guard. So there's a little bit of do-it-yourselfing in that, but nothing too complicated, I guess. Okay, so if you are unfamiliar with my channel, I very much dislike wasting your time and my time. So I'm gonna quickly go over the most important things about this quadcopter. See, you've already seen the product pages, so you know the ins and outs of this quadcopter. What's important about this quadcopter? First of all, this frame. It's a pretty generic frame, maybe. Top plate, all-in-one bottom plate, carbon fiber, and standoffs in between, right? And that's a proven way of building your quadcopter. What's important here is that this is a version 2 frame. The first version had holes in the arms. I haven't had that version myself. I'm not sure what those holes were for. Actually, what were they thinking? Maybe they had their eye on other propeller guards to begin with that required some kind of mounting on the arm over here. Could be. Some prop guards require, as I said, a mount on the arm over here, which might have been what that hole was intended to be used for. Here we see the version 2 frame, which doesn't have those holes anymore, which makes it stronger. Yeah, holes in the arms. Okay, so also this frame is, as you can tell, littered with mounting options for stacks. Some of them are already used, some aren't. Yeah, if you want to reuse this frame or maybe buy the frame separately and build your own quadcopter, there's mounts for at least 2 20x20 stacks and 2 16x16 stacks. Interesting. Yeah, so lots of options there, and that's a benefit of a freestyle frame like this, of course. There's lots of room. Then there's these motors. These are 1106 motors. 3600 kV. And that means that this is not a freestyle quadcopter but a cinematic quadcopter. You'd simply be lacking the actual power to pull off really precise or powerful maneuvers which you see in freestyle videos. You can do light tricks, maneuvers, flips and such. Definitely, it's a brushless quadcopter. But it also means that this will have a longer flight time. It'll eat less power. We'll see that in the flight videos, of course, but I expect 7 to 10 minutes of flight time from this quadcopter. Then, at the front, we have a known quantity in the Caddx Starshay 2-in-1 FPV camera. One of these two lenses you see will be the FPV camera. I think it's the bottom one. I'm not even sure. It doesn't really matter, of course. And the other one will be your action camera, the recorder, 4K and all. And again, this is already a very well-known FPV camera / action camera. There have been some reliability issues with these. I've had 3 myself. They actually did all work. Two of them had a little bit of dust in them. We'll see how this one fares. I should add, by the way, and that's a bit of a con for this quadcopter from HELSC, there's no ND filter with this camera. You can probably order those separately. And if you order this quadcopter, I would suggest you to order that ND filter. Especially if you'd be flying in a sunny climate. And you'd want to use the 30 FPS mode, you'd end up with jello. You definitely want to use an ND filter if you want to use cameras like these in 30 frames a second on sunny days, just so you know. And again, I think those are separately available. Then, let me see, we've got a stack over here, and that's actually an interesting stack. In fact, most of the stack, it's partly obstructed from view, of course, by the prop guards. But most of the electronics you see in the stack are actually the recorder board for that Caddx Starshay. And underneath that, and I'll actually slot in a picture of that, is a 4-in-1 ESC, which is nothing special. However, that same board has the flight controller in it. So you've got a single board here, which houses the 4-in-1 ESC and the F4 flight controller. It's the HELSC Zeus board. It's got a 4-in-1 15 amp, which should be more than enough for the quadcopter, a 4-in-1 ESC, and again, flight controller. So that saves up a lot of room in a build like this, especially vertically, of course. Very interesting flight controller. You can also get that one separately. If you want to build a 3-inch quadcopter, definitely something to have a look at. I haven't done builds myself with this 4-in-1 ESC, but it saves up a lot of room. And at the rear of the quadcopter, there's a VTX and the receiver. But there's a lot of spare room in this frame at the rear and the front. Very, very nice. Okay, one last thing about the frame itself. While handling it, I noticed that there is a little bit of flex in the frame. Well, actually, yeah, there is a little bit of flex in the frame. The base plate, so this bottom plate with the arms, is 2 millimeters. And I'd be worried about that if this would have been a powerful freestyle quadcopter, which it is not, right? It's a cinematic quadcopter. They obviously meant to keep it as light as possible, especially if you are flying the quadcopter with these prop guards, which have a tendency to not only protect the propellers, but also the entire quadcopter. They act like bumpers, if you will. So, no, I'm not worried about the base plate being too fragile or too flexible. Again, if this would have been a powerful freestyle quadcopter, I'd be worried about it flexing, mostly for the performance, the precision of the quadcopter. But again, this is a cinematic long range or endurance, long range, well, mostly endurance quadcopter should be just fine. Let me see. Yeah, I also have a couple of tips on this quadcopter. I checked all the screws and these screws, for instance, and on the top these screws. I checked them all. Those were fine. However, there's one screw holding on this antenna mount at the rear. I did have to tighten that one down a little. And you can actually check that. If you can freely rotate this antenna, which I can't, as you can tell, then you need to tighten up this screw over here. Yeah, you definitely don't want to be able to freely rotate this antenna. That would mean that it's not properly seated. And that'll actually end up having you burn up your VTX or have a horrible reception. But probably both. Yeah, so check that out. If you can freely, easily rotate this antenna, then you need to button up this screw over here, or this mount. And anything else? I think we should take a look at the Betaflight configuration, if there's any work to be done on that. Let's have a looky. Okay guys, let's hook up the USB cable to the quadcopter. And I must add, by the way, that both of the USB ports, both of the flight controller and the KEDEX camera, or the camera recorder, are easily accessible, even with the prop guards in place. That's not always the case with quadcopters like this with propeller guards. Again, both USB ports are easily accessible without straining the USB port or the propeller guards. Okay, we are in beta flight. And the first thing I noticed, and the specs also said that this flight controller has onboard memory, as you can tell over here, data flash. And that means that you can do black box logging. And if you don't know what that is, don't worry. But you can record performance logs of your quadcopter on the flight controller and, have a look at those afterwards to remedy problems, maybe if you run into PID tuning problems and such. So it's nice that the quadcopter or the flight controller has onboard memory. Second thing, and that's hard to read probably, but the Betaflight version on this quadcopter reads 4.1.1, which is relatively recent. So that's great. Very, very nice. Okay, the ports, let me see. The receiver port is configured and smart audio is configured and even ESC telemetry is configured. So this is 100% properly set up, nothing to do for us here. Configuration, D-Shot 600 is correct. And 8K, 8K, whoa, that's ambitious. But they definitely changed the defaults here. Very, very nice. Also, they changed the arming angle. And this means that you can, for instance, if you wind up in a tree with your quadcopter, you can still rearm your quadcopter to try to get it out of the tree or do turtle mode, which I won't advise. But this is, again, evidence that they did have a go over the entire configuration. Okay, quadcopter name, serial S-bus, so they did set up the receiver correctly, very, very nice. In-flight accelerometer calculation, that's a bit uncommon to see. And this is definitely not a default setting of Betaflight. So they must have had a reason for this. I'll leave it as is and we'll just see how this works out. That's a bit, okay. LED strip, well, guess what? The quadcopter does not have an LED strip. So you can for sure disable that. Yeah, and air mode is disabled by default. I'll probably enable that myself, but this is not faulty. And okay, so yeah, this looks fine. Did I change it? I did disable the LED strip. Yeah, okay, so I'll save and reboot. And we'll reconnect. Power. Okay, let me see, nothing out of the ordinary here. If you for some reason want to use an high voltage battery, you'll need to change the maximum cell voltage over here to like 4.4, which I'll do. Save, and the rest we'll just see if this works out. This is all default from the looks of it. PID tuning, let me see. Rate profile, I would advise you to add some exponential over here. I'll be adding 35 35 35. This is especially beneficial in a cinematic quadcopter. If you want to capture smooth videos, a little bit of expo will go a long way. And apart from that, most things actually, this looks pretty much default. Oops, sorry. Looks default. We'll see how this works out, right? I'll leave everything as is. I'll fly the quadcopter in my flight videos as is. Receiver, and I'm pretty sure this will work out. I haven't bound my receiver yet, or my radio. Modes, they did set up some modes. I will probably change things, but angle, yeah, okay, so they added one auto level mode in the middle over here to your fifth channel, fine. And arming also on the fifth channel, that's a bit weird. I would definitely go ahead and change things, but most people will. I always have my arming on a separate switch, aux 2, over here, like so. But air mode, okay, so yeah, they set up air mode over here. I will personally put that in configuration to always have air modes. And they didn't set up flip over recovery turtle mode. All right, fine. Motors, okay, nothing to see here. OSD, this looks pretty much default stuck. Yeah, fine, no problem there. VTX, okay, this is important. They definitely did set up the VTX table, so yeah, this looks proper, great. So basically, yeah, you should be able to fly this quadcopter as is, right out of the box. Most people will change the modes, but at least they added the modes so you could fly the quadcopter right out of the box. And again, I'm happy to see that the Betaflight version is relatively recent. That'll help its performance, definitely. So, my initial impressions of this HGLRC Sector 132 are very positive. The setup, the Betaflight setup, looks proper. They actually put some effort into that, and that's not the case in all ready-to-fly quadcopters. So that's nice. The frame itself, especially the center section, and together with these propeller guards, feels very sturdy. And I'd say this should be a pretty crash-proof quadcopter. It won't be super heavy, which will help its crash resistance, but from experience I know that propeller guards like this will improve its resilience quite a bit. Now, a minute ago, or a couple of minutes ago, I told you that I would personally probably fly it without the propeller guards and the bigger propellers. However, for you, it will probably be more informative to see if it will perform well with these propeller guards and the smaller propellers, right? Let me know in the comment section below, but I think that's fair to say. See, with the 3-inch propellers, I'd be almost 100% sure it would perform well. A modern quadcopter, 3-inch propellers, that would work. However, 2.5-inch propellers? We'll see. We'll see how Betaflight and the flight controller, etc. handles that. And I'm especially interested to see how good that 4-in-1 ESC is. The throttle response and the precision, for instance. Yeah, I'm very interested to see how well that works out and what kind of recordings that will result in. So that is basically what I'll be reviewing, testing with this quadcopter. And that'll actually be coming up pretty soon. I'll have flight reports with this quadcopter in the coming days, weather permitting. I think the weather will permit me to fly the quadcopter in the coming days. So be on the lookout for that. So if you're not subscribed yet, please do. And also ring that bell button so you won't miss out on my flight videos with this HGLRC Sector 132. Now, if you are left with questions, hit me up a comment down below. Catch you on the next video. Bye-bye.